You may remember our previous discussion on the explanation of the role of memory for speech. The point is that memory does play quite an important role. And just because of that memory, regarding the articulation, when I'm using memory, the term memory in this session, then I'm referring to articulation, right? Like, how is articulation based on the previous examples, the background examples of the individual, right, at private level? So we'll explain further points related to the role of memory for speech, right? There is a tendency within phonetic variability that the speech sounds are produced with some variation, right, among individuals, right? So what is the explanation for that, right? And there are many instances of words spoken by the speakers earlier from the past, right? Since we are using language every day with every situation, right? So there are, you know, bulks. There are bulks of stores of the previous examples. And then on the basis of those examples, we are using, you know, a new token, right? A new, representation of the same word. So that is stored in memory. And then there is a theory which is called exemplar theory. Exemplar theory says that the variability is memorized, right? It's not computed. It's memorized and it's stored in memory. And whenever the production of that word is required in future, right? So then it is used by the speaker, right? From the long-term memory, right? So that's a good example to explain. And in order to explain the exemplar theory principles, like one principle is the language universals, okay? So keeping in mind the universal features of language, right? The broad phonetic classes, right? That those examples are, you know, kept in mind on the basis of the memory of the speaker, right? And a very good example is the aspirated sounds versus unaspirated sounds, right? That's the phonetic ability of human being, right? So whenever the aspirated sound is required to be spoken by the person, that's done, right? Unconsciously by the speaker. Similarly, when unaspirated sound is required, it's again at the disposal of the person on the basis of the memory of the person, of the speaker. Then the next example is that the speaking styles. And if you remember the definition of style from your sociolinguistics, then you would know that we speak language as per the situational demand, right? When a person meets, you know, a sweeper, right? So he would change his style of language. Similarly, if the same person would talk to his or her boss, his style would be different. And when a person is making a speech, right, that would be different. An announcement, that would be different. And if you go to police station and talk to the inspector of the police, your style would be different, right? So these are, you know, various possibilities. And that is something which is available to human being, right? On the basis of the speaking style. And that's kept in the memory, right? Then the exemplar theory says that the generalization is also possible within productivity, right? Because ultimately we are concerned with productivity. The hallmark of speech is productivity. That how do you produce, right? So in order to produce one form, which is, variable, right? Which is variable of something, the thing is invariable. So that's generalized. And the variable, part is given to the interlocutor, to the listener, right? And one more point is related to exemplar theory, that the sound change. And how does it change? Like, the sound changes when there is a specific way of the production of that sound carried on by the speakers for a longer time period. Maybe there is a phonetic limitation at the background because of the specific context of the sound, or maybe somewhere when that's the part of the style, right? Or maybe that's the generalization of the productivity, or maybe that's based on language universal, right? So the change would take place, right? And the example is that in English, the word like station, right? So, or shun sound, right? Where sh is involved, that used to be sir, right? Because in past, in the early version of English, that was sir, but then it became sh, right? So now we have sh, shun. In every T-I-O-N construction, the shun sound is there, right? So language change also plays a very important role in this variability in phonetics, right? Like how the variability of phonetics takes place. And then it is invariable because the sound change takes place very slowly, very, very slowly, right? So let me give you an example of the explanation of the memory for speech, that how a specific sound O is produced or U is produced by speakers differently, right? With variation. So let's go to the figure. It is there, and you can see that how this hypothetical cloud for the U sound is given here in citation form, right? So you see how much range is possible. And then in casual forms, right? So the same sound, but for citation forms, different, you know, possibilities. And for casual forms, different possibility, right? And it's a very simple point. So the base with human beings is quite rich. It's the rich base on the basis of which there are various, you know, tokens possible, right? There are various sounds possible, right? And the variations are possible. Then on the basis of those variations, the sounds are produced. And on the shared knowledge basis, the actual meanings are considered by the speakers, right? So the possibilities are enough. And therefore, we have variability in phonetics.